What's going on YouTube? It's Robert Hall, and in today's video, we're going to go back and do episode 2 of the BTS journal, where I go through and break down some shots that I've taken over the past month and talk about the flash and thought process behind creating them. My channel is sponsored by Adorama, which buys me the time to create these type of videos without the influence from any specific camera brand. I personally shop at Adorama for their wide selection on a ton of great products, as well as their support of those products down the road. So if you end up enjoying this video, give it a like, and if you're interested in any of the products in the video, show Adorama some support by using the links in the description below. Everything that I photographed in this video is for my job as an editorial photographer at the university. So you're going to see a lot of environmental portraits today, group portraits, solo portraits, that sort of thing. I want you guys to be clear on the objective of these photos as we go through it, because that's a large portion of this. Is the objective of these photos is generally to highlight some program, person, individual, group. It's always highlighting them for some type of either marketing or internal training materials. Sometimes the images are really limited in what I can do because the composition has to fit whatever type of print medium it's going on. So say it's going to be a full spread across two pages in a magazine, I got to make sure that the gutter, the center of the image, is empty and the subject isn't sitting along there or nothing crucial to the images. And that's something that I've really discovered with this editorial photography position, is that a lot of times my best composition isn't going to be an option strictly because of the medium that it has to fit in, whether that's print or digital. All right, so let's get into it. The first image, this is of a professor in the video department, and I've got a couple shots of him that I wanted to talk about today. So in this environment, it's very dark. They've got like the drape curtains because they're doing all sorts of different productions in here, and I wanted to show off some of those elements in the environment. So that's why you see things like this green screen back here, this lighter curtain, darker curtains, this cart right here for moving film gear in and out, this stage right here. I wanted to show all that off, but this session completely changed when he told me that they have this 5,000 watt for an old Hollywood style Fresnel head on a tripod in the back. So I definitely wanted to show that off. No, they're not still using it. It's just kind of like an antique that is sitting in their studio, but I wanted that to be part of this because I thought it looked so cool. It's just so enormous. So I wanted to show that off. This was not functioning. So it was completely empty. There's no bulb in here. You can see if we zoom in a bit, this little shadow right here is actually the back of the 8200. It's got a round head in there and it's firing into a mirrored panel right here and then flicking back out, showing the light. It's very, very low power, like 1/128th power. Just wanted it to be a little bit of a hair light, but I still wanted you to be able to see those Fresnel details right here. So I wasn't so concerned about it filling him in right here. This is more the ambient light in the room. You can see it on the floor right here as well. I was concerned about still seeing that Fresnel pattern so we could draw emphasis to this as an accent in the scene. So let's talk about color temperatures here. We're looking at a room color temperature of around 3200 Kelvin, right? So 3200 is the room temperature, but I wanted to show off some of that yellow lighting in here. So I have my camera set to around 3800 Kelvin. All right, so this is my camera. And then this, the Fresnel head, we have as a 3200 Kelvin light source. I've got that gelled with a full CTO. And so the last light here in this image is going to be a softbox that's just out of frame, camera left. Got that pointed semi-downward. This is a 28-inch deep parabolic. Pretty close, casting downward so we get those downward shadows underneath the brow, underneath the jaw. We want all of that. That one has a half CTO gel on it. So by having a half CTO gel on the key light as well as the camera being 3800 Kelvin, we basically have a authentic color of his skin where the highlights are, and then it's filled in. It's a little bit warmer because of the ambient light in the room, as well as any light coming from here that's actually hitting him, that's going to be a little bit warmer as well. So this is an example where I'm intentionally getting the color wrong. Not all the color in this image is balanced for one temperature, but that's by design. We want to show off that warm lighting in here just because it's really authentic to the space. So we got another image that I did with him, and you guys might instantly recognize this as like the LCD on a cinema camera, right? That makes sense in our heads. There was a lot of challenges with this one. This is actually a C100. This is one of the cameras that they had lying around. I was like, I think it'd be a cool idea. So this was interesting because this is just a live feed of that camera. So we have to make a bunch of adjustments for the camera itself, the C100. We have to make all these adjustments to that camera so that he looks proper on this screen, followed by the actual camera that we're capturing with, my Sony camera, has to be dialed in to accommodate this LCD screen. So initially I had my camera set to 3200 Kelvin because all the room lighting in there was 3200 Kelvin. But then I realized at the end of the day, I'm going to be photographing a daylight balanced LCD display. So I actually have to be balanced for that. So I flipped to all daylight lighting. In terms of lighting him, we have two light sources. We have two Manfrotto LEDs. And these were just LEDs that they had set up in there. Manfrotto LED right there, and another one hitting him here. So we've got both of those set to daylight. So they're 5500 Kelvin. Camera white balance, the C100's white balance is 5100K. Now we had to go LED here so that he would display on the screen nice and brightly. If we did this with flash, there would probably be a little bit of delay, and on top of that, this definitely wouldn't show the entire image being lit with flash through this viewfinder. Like, that just wouldn't work. If you've ever seen a video where flash goes off, you know it only lights a portion of the scene. So we had to flip to LED here. Now, I really liked how this photo came out. The only thing I didn't like is that to us, this makes sense. We recognize it as a C100. However, anybody else looking at this probably has no idea what, like, all of this stuff is over here. Like, you can kind of see Canon right here, but the average person just doesn't know what type of device this is, and I'm not appealing to photographers, I'm appealing to a different audience. So they have to understand what the heck we got right here. So the only adjustment that I actually made was shining an LED directly on here, and you can see the color doesn't quite match up. This isn't neutralized over here, and that's because I'm using the 8200 LED, which is a little bit warmer than these Manfrotto LEDs that were in the background. But now you can clearly see like a battery, you can clearly see the buttons, the skip backwards, stop, play, all those buttons make sense. So the average viewer is going to have a much better understanding of what all of this is versus somebody looking at this image. So that was kind of the goal for those type of adjustments. All right, up next, this is a very simple one light portrait. Wanted it to be a little bit warmer, kind of have some warm tones going in here. Again, the university that I work for, I've mentioned this in previous videos, their colors are gold and black, so I don't necessarily mind when things are a bit overly warm in the backgrounds. So in other situations where I might really make sure to neutralize that background and get perfectly white or gray colors in the background, for the university that I work for, I don't worry about it so much. So you can see the Oxford University shirt, and you can see the flag of the UK here. So for this, there's actually a person. There's a person right on the left out of frame, and they are holding either end of the flag on the left side. So that's what makes the Union Jack have these ripples and motion to it, is them just walking away. Light, again, single 28-inch deep parabolic, camera left, lighting up the flag, lighting up the person's face, giving us some nice loop lighting, and then it's just ambient light filling in on this side of the face as well as the background. So a very simple light setup. I think the reason she was giggling in this photo is because she had just got hit in the face on the previous photo with the flag being brushed around. So that worked out great for a really authentic smile. So right here, this is pretty much the ambient environment that we were shooting in. It's a lab with all the curtains brought down, so it's pretty dark on the inside. Then you've got this one light. This wasn't really a test or anything. I just had this light set up for this shot. This is just an 8200 with a blue gel on it that I had firing. But what I was looking at here was the ambient light on everybody else's faces. So the goal of this image was to make this guy stand out. He's the professor here. He's the star of the show, but I wanted all these other students to still be clearly visible. So we want to put emphasis on this professor, but still have these guys kind of be an accessory to the image. We brought down the ambient light, made it as dark as possible in there. I had them each take their laptops and make them as bright as possible. Turn the brightness up all the way. And I wanted them all to go to the brightest screen possible, so an all white screen. That way I've got a lot of light illuminating each of their faces. I really like how it looks on this gentleman right here. We can see that strong cast. So we've got a teal light in the background now. And I believe at this point is when I switched to mag mod. So we've got a mag mod teal gel in the background on the Fresnel head. And then I have a 5-foot glow umbrella that is just out of the frame over here. That's what we're looking for to create the pattern of emphasis, the light pattern on this gentleman right here. While all these guys still have pretty good, once they tilted their heads downward and looking at the screen, that's pretty good fill from the monitors right in front of them. And then there's just a little bit of light on their face that gives them some pattern, and that's from the umbrella. So we've got umbrella light hitting them. You can see that the professor is still a little bit brighter, which is intentional. But once I did this shot and reviewed it, I really liked these details in the back right here. So often at the university, we are looking for what to put on whiteboards. We want to put some studious elements on the whiteboard. So when it naturally exists, I always want to highlight it. And I just didn't think that this really added much to the scene. It looks enterprising, it looks technical because of the blue color, but the shape of it just skipping off of his shoulder is a little bit underwhelming. So I actually completely switched up what we've got going on here, and I used the mag beam with the slash pattern. And so that just creates like a little pronounced light. And I like that because it looks like it's leaking in from the side here and you really have no idea what the light source is. But again, because of the teal bluish color, fits the tech vibe while emphasizing this right here. And also by turning it away from the camera, we don't have any distracting rim light right off the shoulder right here. See, in this one, it just kind of calls attention to your eye, but in here, I feel like the eye goes more right to this professor with the light pattern on his face. So that works a lot better. So this was the final, and it's really what we were looking for. And anybody judging from a photography perspective would be like, what are all these distracting elements? Again, guys, if it's fitting the environment, if it's really natural to the environment, then we kind of want to show it rather than hide it. All right, so this was probably one of my most challenging shoots of the week. This gentleman, the whole story about creating this image and what this is for, the story that this image is going to accompany, is about this man is trying to start a program or launch a program. He's already started it, trying to get funding for a program in which he teaches literature to people that are in jail as part of a rehabilitation process. So we wanted to somehow create the jail environment, which is tough to do at a university. Now, we did have access to this room, and these cinder blocks, you know, they're really plain, but they look like they could be in a jail, right? So there's a lot of visual elements that didn't really match up here, though. Primarily this window just does not fit the jail vibe, because look, you could just grab this little latch right here and jump right out. Wouldn't be too effective of a jail. And I really needed a way to drive it home. So what we had thought about was creating some type of bar pattern, so it looked like there was light shining through bars. We had some hint of bars, which I'm pretty sure most prisons don't even use bars, but it's the easiest way to communicate it to an audience. So that's what most people think of when they think of being in jail, is being behind bars, right? So the first thing I tried was the mag mod, again the same tool that we used last time, this time with a graded pattern. But the problem with it is that it casted these shadows and highlights that were equally sized, so you've just got this striping effect. And it doesn't look natural to bars at all, right? The bars are going to be much thinner than the areas of light in between them. So this wasn't going to cut it. So we addressed a lot of things in the next image here. Now, obviously, we still have this window to deal with, but having it closed gets rid of that latch, which gets rid of that easy exit opportunity. So I think that this sells it a lot more. Now, the big part here would be these shadows, how we manage to create these shadows, because they look way better or way more authentic to bars than the shadows in this image do. And so all we did was 4 light stands. You can see right up here, this is actually like the twist knob, which is why it's thicker than the rest of the bar. But those light stands made for a much more accurate portrayal. It also gave us the ability to space them out. We couldn't really modify the pattern that we had with the mag mask for the mag beam. So now we've just got a bare Fresnel head firing through four light stands, and then I've got, again, 28 inch softbox coming in on him just to light him a little bit more pleasantly, because if we just went with the hard light, then it would look really ugly. So that filled in this shadow a little bit right here on his shirt and made for a little bit better of a light pattern on his face than there would be if we just used that Fresnel head. Now let's talk about some other visual elements here. I've got his sleeves rolled up, right? This guy's going to work. We're trying to show that. He's trying to do something that's very difficult. So rather than the clean and polished look, I really like the sleeves rolled up. We've got the book right here. It's open. It seems like he's in the process. There could totally be somebody right on the other side of the room that he is reading or teaching or listening to. Also, the overall tone of the image, you can see that it's a little bit cooler and a little bit more dramatic. Like these highlights in here and these shadows, they have a little bit of a blue tone to them. So it's definitely a cooler image overall. All of this is designed to invoke the mood of what he's going after. Now, I don't have too much to talk about with this image. In this image, we've got a 28 inch softbox camera left and a gridded 8200. Here, let me draw a quick grid. Gridded 8200 camera right. That's what's creating the separation right here on the neck. So I like this image, but it wasn't as dramatic as I wanted. And I also thought that the front was a little bit flat using this light source right here. So I just wanted to create a little bit more depth to the image. And this is kind of where I finalized the image. This one's still a little bit crooked because it's straight out of camera, but it's still the same 28 inch softbox. It was just pushed about two more inches away from me, which makes it so that none of that light reaches this whole cheek region and we get a much stronger shadow. Now you can see that rear light poking through, hitting his jaw a little bit, but still giving us that light right here. We've also got a stronger highlight on the shoulder right here, and then it just gets completely dark right over here, which just does a lot to emphasize and texturize the image. Moving that light 2 inches completely changed the overall feel of it. I mean, this is the difference that moving the light maybe 2 inches makes to an image. So just being really particular about where you position a light can completely change the mood and aesthetics and lighting qualities of the image. Okay, again, this is pretty much straight out of camera, but the idea here with this one is this student is very community driven, active with other students, and always kind of leading the conversation, right? So the focus, the story is on this student, and we wanted a lot of other bodies and students around just so that you got the idea that he's part of a larger group. So while I want all these extras to be in the image, I don't want your eye to be caught by any of them. So we picked this really bright starting point, this room full of windows. You can see the sun shining through, which just adds another nice little visual characteristic. It's very bright and inspiring when you can see the sun in the photo and kind of that lens flare look. So we tend to utilize that a lot. Stop down until pretty much everything in here was dark, so got the aperture down quite a bit. For this, I wasn't really into using high speed sync. I want you to be able to see these people clearly in the background. So to drop that exposure down, we're not using our shutter speed, I'm using my aperture. I'm fairly certain that this image ended up at f8. So by choosing that f8 and a very bright background and then having all these students in silhouette, you know they're there, but they're not really capturing your attention because the subject is still brighter than the rest of them. And then all I had to do to achieve this look is have the softbox, 28 inch deep parabolic, right out of frame. I mean, it is like right around here, just out of frame on the top right. I'm pretty close here. Also creates emphasis on him through the wide angle aspect of the lens, which is why he looks so much larger than all these other students. So we're drawing attention with wide angle distortion, we're drawing attention with lighting and composition. We've got these lines going, all kind of pointing right towards him from either end of the frame, really draws attention to the subject in multiple ways. So by having this lighting really close and pointing downwards, we ensure that we're not casting any light into all these other students in the room, which would ruin that whole silhouette that we were looking for. So there's two things there. The direction of the light is making sure that it's not going into all those other students. And then inverse square law, we've got the light hitting him. It's very intense on him, but since it's so close, by the time it reaches all the other subjects, it's not influencing them at all. So that's why you don't see any light on these other people, both the direction of light and the inverse square law. That's why I always tell you that the science of lighting is so important, is because when you get into this situation and you're hitting everybody with light, if you know things like the inverse square law, then you know why and you can easily adapt to that challenge. Alright guys, that is this month's BTS journal. Hope you guys enjoyed it. If you did, please leave it a like. If you have any questions, go ahead and leave it in the comments below. All the camera, lenses, lighting, accessories, all that gear is listed in the description below if you're interested in any of those products. Subscribe to my channel if you'd like to see more of my videos, and until next time, keep on shooting.